to NICU Stories. Hey, my NICU Story followers. Welcome back to another episode of NICU Stories. We have a wonderful guest today, Cailin Werner. How are you, Cailin?
I'm doing great. Excited to be here with you.
Cailin has such a beautiful business or brand that she is launching, and she has an incredible story all her own. So I'm excited to have you on today to share your story with us and to promote your brand. That's going to be such a blessing and a support to other NICU parents. So
Cailin, it's going to be fun.
Take it away.
Okay. I have three beautiful boys. All three of them were born preterm. My first one was born at 34 weeks, 3 days, something like that, close to 35 weeks, perfectly healthy, 5 pounds on ounces, came home with me, no issues. I was like, wow. So when I had my second son, things got a little bit different. And he was actually a scheduled C-section, but I had gone into labor anyways the same day of my C-section. So went in, standard C-section, and when they took him out, Kyler was blue and was not breathing on his own. And so they rushed him past me. I didn't get to see him. And I have a heart condition, so they took me down to the cardiac ward for 24 hours and wouldn't let me see him. So I had no clue if he was alive, what was going on. So when I finally got up to the NICU to see him and they released me, he had to be on the CPAP. He was just a 7 pounds, 11 ounces, big boy, and just was not a good breather. He just decided he was going to be a lazy breather. And then his sugar levels were off. But within about a week, that all resolved. And he stayed in the NICU for, I think, 6 days, 7 days. And he came home and was just fine. And so my husband and I sat around and debated, do we want to go for one more? I don't know. Two boys is already a lot. And God chose for us. We got baby number three, which he was a pretty easy pregnancy. Besides, I was sick every day, every single day that I was pregnant with him to the day I had that baby. I was throwing up. I was miserable. About 28 weeks, I started going into labor. And so they put me on the McKenna and started giving me shots for steroid shots to beef up his lungs and everything. And he lasted to 32 weeks. We made it another month. And my husband was gone with military. And I had our babysitter next door was helping me with the other two because I was on bed rest. And I had to go downstairs to her and say, would you feel comfortable driving me to the hospital? Aww. I felt so bad. This little 18-year-old girl's like, oh my God, running around, freaking out. So we get to the hospital. My husband meets us there, and they do decide, because he was showing signs of being in distress. So they went ahead and took Caden, and he was amazing. He was doing great. And I mean, great. Was breathing fine, holding his own. The doctors were like, whoa, you know, and he's a fighter. He was fighting them coming out from the second he was swinging at people from the second he was born. Poor doctors. And, you know, so they took him over to the NICU, and they were amazing and wheeled me over to the NICU, still in my hospital bed, drugged out of my mind.
Yep.
didn't even know where I was, but I got to hold him for the first time, and it was just the best. You know, he was 4 pounds, 9 ounces, so he was a little tyke. And do some post-ops, refused to stay in my room. And So they had him taking care of Caden. He was doing great. I kept bugging the nurses to go back and forth to the NICU. I feel horrible for it, but I refused to leave. I couldn't leave him. And something in my gut, I knew something wasn't right. I just knew it. And yeah, they were preparing us to go home. And I mean, he was only 33 weeks old. And they were like, no, he's breathing on his own. He's holding everything. He started, able to hold his body temperature, regulate his own body temperature. And I just, he was eating. I mean, he was great.
And wow.
Something in my gut, I was just like, not right. And the nurse looked over at me, and next thing I know, she walked away, and I look down, and he's having a grand mal seizure in my arms. And I looked up at the nurse and I said, he's having a seizure, isn't he? And she looked at me and said, Mama, just hold your baby close. And so I did. And after that one passed, they put him on the table and tried to figure out exactly what was going on. And, you know, he kept seizing after that one, after another. And I mean, it was probably the worst hour of my life. They put him on like two different seizure meds, trying to get it to stop. And they finally got it to stop. And, I mean, he was so heavily sedated. It was terrifying. It was unbelievably terrifying. They started IVs, but he was so little that the veins kept blowing. So I think they did like seven different IVs. It was like in each leg and each hand multiple times. And his little arms were just purple. And I mean, it was horrible to sit there and watch. And I watched one of the nurses check his IV, and she looked over at me and she pointed to his head and she said, now that's a good vein. Me not even thinking anything, I was like, yeah, okay. Because I had never even heard of it before. I was like, yeah, okay, stay away from my kid's head. You know, don't touch my kid's head.
Right.
And so I just kind of ignored it. And the doctors were trying to figure out what's going on. And for all moms who have mom guilt in general, and the stress of having a NICU baby, you know, we've all gone through that. And I was, my emotions and my feelings were swirling. And I had a doctor walk up to me, and this was the day he started seizing and things were going crazy in the NICU. And I was just a wreck. And he walked up to me and said, what are you on? I said, what? And he said, what are you on? What have you taken? Test me. And he was like, fine. So when the doctor accused me of being on stuff, I quickly told him to test me, test my husband, do whatever you want to do, test the baby. And they did. And never did he come back and apologize, you know. And right about the time he was accusing me of stuff, this amazing doctor, and I hold him in the highest regard, he's a pediatric, a withdrawal seizure. You can tell the difference. Look at this child. He's not twitching. He's not crying. He's not having. And he looked over at me and said, Mama, you're doing a great job. And it took that one doctor to support me and tell me that I was okay, that really changed the way I was doing things. And it changed my mental ability to handle everything. And I refused to leave Cailin at the hospital. Refused. And so finally, the doctors looked at me and said, listen, if you get sick, we won't allow you back in. You got to go home. So I told my mom, and my dad came up from Oklahoma, and we set up a schedule where somebody was with him 24/7, because I had to know somebody was there while he was so unstable. And they would just sit there with him and take care of him and watch him. And, you know, and I got a call from my mom the first night that they convinced me to go home. It was the first night. And she called and she's like, Cailin, they're putting an IV in his head. And I was like, I'm sorry, what? And she was like, well, they've decided to move his IV site. And I was like, they're putting a needle in my kid's head. Like, I didn't know. And like, you know, when you're that tired and that emotional, yeah, you call me before you do something like that, you know? And so I look at my husband's like, get me back up there. We're going now. He was like, oh, great. he said other words, but,
keep it PG.
We went right back up to the hospital, and I walked in, and I walked into the NICU, and I said, what did y'all do? And the nurse was like, okay, Mrs. Werner, just listen. And I was like, you stuck a needle in his head. he has a needle in his head. And she was like, you know, and to me, I'm so tired and so emotional. I didn't understand that, you know, it's not going in, it's just on the surface. And finally, one of the charge nurses came over and explained everything to me. And I sat down beside him and I looked up and because regulate his body temperature. So when they did the scalp IV so they could have full visual abilities of it, they took his hat off. Well, then he couldn't regulate his body temperature. So they had to go back into the incubator or the isolate. Mm. And so it was like we went 2 steps forward, 10 steps back. You know, we were going home and now we were right back like when he was, you know, first gone in. And so finally I looked over at the nurse and I was like, you need a hat. And she said, what? And I said, you need a hat for that IV. And she said, you know, we would give anything to have a hat with a hole in it. And I looked over at my mom in that moment and I said, we're making a hat. And I mean, I don't know if my mom thought I was crazy or what. She was like, yeah. I was like, no, we're making a hat. And she was like, okay. And so I started researching that night. I wouldn't leave him again. So they decided until he was stable, the hospital gave me the care by care room. So I was able to stay at the hospital with him as long as he was having the grand mal seizures. And I had a, you know, queen size bed and TV and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, wow.
And so they convinced me to go back in there. And so I go into the care by care room. Yeah. So I go back in there and I start doing research. They had a little desk set up where I mean, my computer, and I was like, scalp IVs, hats with the scalp IV. I couldn't let it go. I mean, it became my purpose.
Wow.
That makes sense. Perfect sense. It was, I don't want another child to have to. Yeah. I don't want another baby and another parent to go through what I just went through. And so, you know, I became, you know, a man on a mission, woman on a mission, matter of fact. And so, needless to say, Cailin got much better. He started making huge strides. We finally got, you know, the feeding tube out and he was able to come off one of the seizure meds. And, so we got to go home. And as soon as we got home, I called my mom and I was like, okay, started making a hat. She was like, oh, you're not kidding. I was like, no, I'm not kidding. We're making it happen. And so we decided, you know, we started researching. Yeah, I'm not playing. You know, I sat down and thought about all the things that were so important to me when I was in the NICU with Cailin. And if you can think back to when you were in the NICU and, you know, you have this tiny little baby and they start taping you and taping cords to you and to the chairs to make sure you're not yanking on any cords while you have skin to skin. I mean, it was just crazy the amount of tape they put on me and my child. I'm like, this is craziness. And when I would try to breastfeed Cailin, the cords kept going down in his face and then they would tape cords to the side of his head. And I mean, he was 6 weeks old when he finally came home and he had cords everywhere. I mean, he had tape residue still on his head a week later, you know, and I would use the little alcohol swabs that they sent home trying to get the tape stuff off. And I was like, you know, them in comparison to what it feels like on us taking a Band-Aid off, it has to be miserable. Yeah. And so, you know, I sat down and we started thinking, okay, for this hat, I would like to have it to where, you know, it covers the whole head, leaves the, you know, the site open for all sorts of, you know, whether they have to have an IV or a shunt or something like that. So you can have multiple panels out at one time, because sometimes babies have to have more than one IV going. And so you can have multiple sites open. You know, a nurse can have full access to the IV at all times, but it's kind of a happy hat and it's happy, bright colors, and it distracts a little bit. You can't make this better. Mm-mm. I can't take away a scalp IV. It is terrifying and it is grotesque to look at. And I mean, when you're sitting there staring at it, you don't understand that it's not, you just keep thinking that it's simple. You know, we decided to do the tabs on the side of where the hat opens. So the cords, it's little tiny Velcro. So the cords will keep it out of the baby's face. So you can see your little one's face. Don't you remember that first time you saw your baby's face without any cords or breathing apparatuses on it? And you're like, oh my God, he's so cute. And you get so excited and you get your phone out and you start taking pictures, you know, and this helps you move the cords away. They can tape it to the hat and not to the baby's skin. You know, the hat is kept together by Velcro, and I tested out like 15 different Velcros to find the absolute softest Velcro you can find. And then we found 100% interlock cotton, which is the softest cotton you can get, you know, and for Matronee and for me and my mom, it was important to have everything US sourced, US made. So we know exactly where it's coming from. It's coming from us over, you know what I mean? I've put my hands on it. I've inspected it. I know what's going out, and I know what I'm giving these moms, like I said, will never take away that fear, but maybe, just maybe, it can make it a fraction better.
Right.
If I can make it just a fraction better, I've done what I set out to do. I've made it better. And that's kind of what our goal's always been, is we can't take it away. We can't change it. It is what it is. But if we can make it better for the patient, you know, you're helping with, you know, keeping heat in on the baby's head. So then they're not wasting all of the calories trying to warm themselves. They're actually building some chunk up on them. We need those babies to fatten up. You know, you're making it easier on the nurses, because if you want those babies home, and those IVs on their hands and their wrists, they're blowing constantly. And that's really hard on the nurses. And so you turn around and you have, it's easier on the nurses to be able to place a scalp IV, which is, because if you think about it, babies can't move their heads around that much, but they sure as heck. I mean, I know my son, like I said, was swinging coming out. He was ready to fight. And every time they would come at him with an IV, he started just wailing, you know, and I kept going, no, you know. You know, and just to think, you know, okay, so now they're not blowing IV. So it makes it easier on the nurses, which in turn makes the doctor's job easier. You know, it's just a win-win for everybody. And I think that's what was so important to me is, yes, as a parent, you want to make it better. We do. You know, when your son comes in or your daughter comes in with a scraped knee, oh, baby, I'm so sorry. And you put a Band-Aid on it. You're like, all right, get back out there. Go. You know, and that's kind of what we're trying to do. It's just a Band-Aid.
I absolutely love it. And one of the things that you hit on, why this cap is so important is because, or just such a beautiful thought behind it, is that we want to be able to see the baby's face. And we have all those cords and just all these other things. And that was such a pivotal moment when my daughter finally didn't have the cannula in her mouth. And, you know, she had like a smaller little breathing tube. I was like, oh my God, I finally get to see your little face. Like, you know, little things like that that we typically take for granted, that you absolutely have the opportunity now. And what's the name of your brand?
My company's name is Matronee, and it's M-A-T for, it's like the three mothers. So it's the sign of the three mothers for the Celtic women. And so Maddie cap is what we call it, M-A-T-I cap. Just make it easy. You know, we thought about certain things when we were doing it. Every cap is color coordinated. So if you have a blue one, you know, you're going to have a small. If you have a green one, you're going to have a medium. If you have an orange one, it's a large. And then we have micro preemie size. And those are just white. And, you know, it makes it easy for the nurse. They're like, okay, he's going to need a blue Maddie cap. And so that way, a nurse can easily go and grab a blue one and know that that's a small. You don't have to really sit there and focus on it. You know, I think what's hard right now and what we're noticing is a lot of hospitals are considering this an extra expense. And for us as parents, we're looking at them going, that's worth it to me to know that my baby is a little bit more comfortable. You know, you're charging 20 used repeatedly over and over again. I've washed one 64 times. I put it in my laundry for 2 full months every day and it held up. And I'm like, you know, I think if it gives the baby comfort, that's kind of what our goal is.
Right.
You know, and, you know, maybe you wouldn't have to use so much medical equipment and stuff if you just pay attention to what the needs are. That's just kind of what my thinking, my thought process is.
And the other part that you mentioned that is why this is so important to have is that you want the baby to stay warm, because the little beanies are not just to be cute, but it's to help them maintain their body temperature. So if you have a child who has
exactly
a scalpel IV, they're kind of fighting a little harder to maintain body temp versus any other preemie. So of course that will prolong their stay because
exactly
they're fighting for the weight, they're fighting for the calories. So it's a definite need. You definitely are raising awareness in regards to scalpel IVs, because I'm going to be honest, I've never heard of it until you said it. And I've been, you know, working in the NICU community for so long, and you're like the first person to have mentioned it. So I'm pretty sure the fact that this is being done, you're not the only person to have had the experience with your baby having to have a scalpel IV.
Well, and people will call it a unicorn IV and try to make it sound cute. No matter what you do, the darn thing is not cute, you know, and you can't make it go about it. But, you know, let's see if we can soften the blow a little bit. Right. You know what I'm saying?
So what I'm excited about is that Cailin and her mom is this team. Is there another person part of your team? It's mainly you and your mom, right?
No, it's me and my mom. Our husbands are kind of on the back, silent partners, you know, but it's kind of, it's me and my mom. We've done it all. We've done all the manufacturing, all the designing, all of the patent. It's been women strong taking over, you know, it's exciting. It's exciting to finally see it come to fruition.
Mm-hmm. So I absolutely love that. It's a mommy brand. It's a mom and mom brand. And, you know, I really excited to hear the future of where Matronee goes. I know that you guys have a big reputable company that you're meeting with, and I'm really praying for success for you. And that this is, hopefully we'll have an update when your episode airs that there's a contract or something involved, but we're definitely keeping you prayer here over the NICU story.
Thank you.
You know, if it's not them, it'll be another, or just multiple people reaching out, multiple hospitals reaching out. But
here's the one thing that we're also doing. Yes, you can order a cap for your child online. Not a problem. We can send it directly. If you are wanting to go ahead and order caps and just send them to your hospital for other NICU moms, we're doing those as well. You just have to send us a little note and tell us how many you want sent to that hospital, and we can send, you know, in care of blah, 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 and this is from you to your NICU hospital. So that way it just kind of, you know, we had one mom that was like, I just want to send one as a thank you. And so let other moms know we're here for them. You know, because we're a tight-knit community. When you talk to other moms, yes, we're moms, but NICU moms, it's a whole different ball game. We have been through what is considered a war and a battle, and we are coming out with battle scars, whether the emotional or their actual scars. And so we have learned as a community to really come together. And that's what's so amazing. And when you have other moms that are going, I just want to send these to a couple of NICU moms, just anonymously from, you know, and that's what we've done a couple of times, and just sent them over to the hospital. And so, you know, for the next time a scalp IV is used, this is from the Jones family, you know, and so that way it really does support them, you know.
Right.
It's pretty cool. We're proud of that.
I absolutely love it. And I love what the work that you're doing. And I hope that you continue to knock on these doors. Don't give up until there's breakthrough. And thank you for sharing that information. Can you also share your social media information that people can follow you and your mom on social media and your website?
Absolutely. We are on Instagram, and it's Matronee 18 because it was the year Cailin was born. MATRONEE18. We are also on same as Instagram, same thing, or Twitter, sorry. And then our website is www.matronee.com. You can go to the About Us page in there. We have an amazing video that really tells every process that we went through and kind of how we became and who, how we do what we do. Because I'm still a mother of three and a photographer, and now I'm doing this. And, you know, it's as moms, you just make it work, you know? And so definitely if anybody needs anything, just reach out. We'll do whatever we can. Mm-hmm. Making it work.
I love it. Thank you so much, Cailin. And give your mom love from us as well, and your silent partner husbands.
Absolutely.
And give your son definitely love from us as well. I appreciate you coming on and sharing your story, because, you know, as I always say, it's not easy to share this NICU journey, especially, you know, the trauma of the NICU, which a lot of people just do not realize. And some people.
No. Well, and I had to have a counselor, and I had a counselor. Yeah, I had a counselor coming out of the NICU. I had to have somebody to talk to help me process. And I think that's huge, because postpartum depression and, you know, and if you think about it, you have a lot of PTSD. I mean, because I can smell things and it, boom, take me right back. And I think a lot of us as moms, we're strong. We can handle it. But if you have somebody to lean on, leaning back, you know, so as parents, yes, we have been through it, but we are there for you. And Matronee will be there for you. If you need somebody to lean on, come lean on us.
I love it. Come lean on Matronee. That's why I love this NICU community, because it really,
lean on me.
It really is a community where
we absolutely.
And we look out for each other. And it's just a different kind of bond that the NICU community has, which I absolutely love. But Cailin, I thank you again. And I thank you to all the listeners. Please go out and follow her, follow Matronee, follow and purchase some of these caps, get it into the hospitals, make awareness of why this is necessary and why it's needed, especially for these unique babies in these unique situations, just to see that the hospitals need to know that this is important and it's a necessity. So purchase these caps.
Absolutely.
If you purchase one or two or three, purchase them and send them out. And we just thank you here at NICU Stories for sharing your story and promoting your brand and making awareness of this necessity that a lot of parents need in the NICU. Thank you, Cailin.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It was a blast.
I know, it really was. And I thank
you. Have a great day. Awareness.
Thank you, everyone, and have a wonderful evening.